The following documentary was produced by the Department of National Defense in cooperation with our sponsors and in line with its mandate to promote the welfare and to preserve the legacy of Filipino war veterans. It tells the story of thousands of heroic young men who braved incredible odds in Bataan and Corregidor to defend their motherland. It brings us to a proud moment in our history when Filipinos from all walks of life closed ranks in the spirit of sacrifice and patriotism to fight a common enemy. May their story inspire us all.
In 1941, just before World War II became a traumatic reality on our soil, young Filipinos were having the time of their lives. After all, the Philippines then was a colony of the mighty United States of America, and it seemed like there was nothing to worry about. Little did these young Filipinos know that they would soon be called to defend their country. Virtually overnight, they would change from carefree boys to full-grown men the size of heroes. I'm Joel Torre. Join me in the next hour as we listen to their story, the story of the defenders of Bataan and Corregidor, and the legacy they left you and me. Their story recounts a fight against hopeless odds, a saga of courage, of sacrifice, of duty to country.
Ay, Pilipino ako. Dumating yung mga kahaway natin. Siyempre naman, sumuyo tayo sa bansa natin. With or without American help, we would have done it anyway.
Somehow we did not quite realize how a war would be.
Personally, I thought it was a picnic.
We were faced with an enemy that was determined to eradicate you.
They underestimated the Japanese, and we paid the price for that.
We thought that we will die.
We had no idea that we were going to get no reinforcements.
If we did not receive any order, we would not have surrendered.
We were going to fight to the end like the Alamo.
Why were we doing it? Who for? What for?
The Filipinos did most of the fighting and most of the dying, right?
Kung ikaw ay tapat sa bayan, maalala mo pareho.
...1941 marked the end of a nostalgic period called peacetime. After 5 years of the Philippine Commonwealth under American tutelage, life in the islands rolled along blissfully, with institutions, infrastructure, and industries taking root, and the promise of independence just 5 years away. The atmosphere seemed full of gaiety and hope.
Thank you. years of my life, I would say, in UP, there were a lot of beautiful girls.
Tumutulong ako sa parents ko para mag-vendor ng ika nga eh, yung pang-almusal.
At Arellano High School, magkano'ng tuition, 4 pesos a year.
The government is very efficient. There is no graft and corruption.
I used to go with my grandmother to hear mass in Intramuros in the morning, and I used to stay for a while to watch these soldiers of the 31st Infantry drilling.
They call them the thirsty firsters, because if ever they did anything, they drank a lot of beer and Geneva gin and the whole bit. So one of the reasons why so many people wanted to be assigned to the Philippines, it was considered good living for a soldier. And it remained that way until spring of 1941, when it began to heat up, where we knew that this was no longer a pleasure cruise, it was something very serious.
But elsewhere in the world, war clouds gathered as the European colonial powers and the United States braced to stem the march of fascism across their territories. After the U.S. opposed Japan's invasion of China, it became clear that the two military powers were on a collision course. At some point, the Japanese would consider hitting U.S. bases around the world, making the Philippines an obvious target. Despite the danger, many believed that Japan would not dare challenge the might of the United States. The myth of American invincibility gave Filipinos a false sense of security.
Yes, we knew that war was coming, but we were so sure that it would only last for a couple of days, principally due to the propaganda by the Americans through the movies.
What can Japan do against America? That was the thing that we were thinking of.
Nevertheless, the Philippine Commonwealth prepared its own defense plans. Under the direction of its military advisor, General Douglas MacArthur. Young men were periodically called for training. In college, there was the ROTC. But with scarce and obsolete weaponry, these drills were more like a rite of passage and a venue for benign inter-school competition.
During maneuvers, we used firecrackers to simulate firing. And for artillery, we used the bamboo cannon.
In July 1941, Japan took over southern French Indochina. The U.S. responded sharply, freezing Japanese assets and embargoing all oil to Japan. General MacArthur was placed in command of the USAFE, the U.S. Army forces in the Far East. Reserve officers and men were called to duty, and last-minute training commenced, even as equipment and weapons awaited shipment to the Philippines.
It was the fun at that time, to be seen, to be counted, to be counted.
On December 8, 1941, Philippine time, Japan launched a surprise attack on the big U.S. naval base at Pearl Harbor. Within 6 hours, Japanese bombs hit Baguio and Davao without warning. The U.S. and the Philippines have been dragged into the World War.
Immediately after the mass, nag-issue ng steel helmet, nag-issue ng yung talagang sagiran talaga.
The cadet corps cheered because to us, we thought no more academics, no more school.
The cadet officers of the cadet corps were assigned to the 1st Regular Division. And most of us were assigned as commanding officers of frontline infantry companies.
Thousands of volunteers from all walks of life, many without any military training, rushed to enlist to defend their motherland. Some had to be sent home for lack of weapons.
We feel then that it is a duty to do for the country.
I told myself, I was very young then, oh, this is a good experience.
As volunteers filled the recruiting stations, those already in uniform built defensive positions in selected beaches where the Japanese might land. There, MacArthur planned to stop the enemy. The beaches would be the front lines. From the first day of the war, the field American defenders were at a disadvantage. Most of the planes of the USAFE had been demolished by a surprise attack on Clark and Eba fields.
Buildings on Fort Stotzenberg were blown up. It was awful. And then about 10 minutes later, in came the Japanese Zeros, strafing and firing and bombing. It was a catastrophe.
2 days after the first wave of attack, Japanese planes destroyed the U.S. Navy base at Cavite. Filipino and American pilots flying outmoded aircraft heroically tried to challenge the swift and lethal Japanese Air Force. Among the most courageous was Captain Jesus Villamor, whose daring exploits earned him a Distinguished Service Cross. With the Japanese in control of the air and sea, the defense of the Philippines would fall on the shoulders of ordinary foot soldiers, many of whom had no idea of what war was really like.
We were singing the Hail Ate Deo Hail on to the free, as if we were going to a basketball game.
Many of them didn't even have arms in the beginning. They didn't have uniforms. Many of them didn't have anything but tennis shoes.
We have at the time the Enfield rifles on the model 1917.
Battle tested and armed with more efficient weapons, the Japanese landed in Apari, Vigan, and Legazpi to seize airfields before arriving en masse in Lingayen Gulf on December 22. Few of these landings were seriously challenged because MacArthur initially thought that they were purely diversionary.
They had anti-tank guns, they had flamethrowers, they had big artillery pieces, they had thousands of foot soldiers, and we were not expecting that.
But after the Japanese had established beachheads and began pushing inland, MacArthur was forced to implement War Plan Orange, an old defensive plan which he had previously discarded. This called for the withdrawal of all USAFE troops in Luzon to the thickly forested Bataan Peninsula. There, together with the heavily fortified island of Corregidor, they could deny any enemy the use of Manila and its strategic harbor. Entrenched in their positions, USAFE troops were simply expected to hold out until reinforcements arrived.
One of the things that General MacArthur never planned for, he planned for the troops. He planned for Filipinos and Filipino scouts, the Philippine Army, and the American forces to come to Bataan. But he did not figure that there would be almost 40,000 civilians that were going to come into Bataan seeking security.
He left enormous quantities of food, ammunition, and medicine up north.
To prevent further civilian casualties and damage to property, Manila was declared an open city and cleared of military personnel. President Manuel Quezon and his family, together with select members of his cabinet, were evacuated to Corregidor. By New Year's Day 1942, all USAFE forces in Luzon were entering Bataan, confident that it would only be a matter of time before reinforcements would come. But the question was, how long could the defenders of Bataan and Corregidor hold out? On January 2, 1942, the Japanese occupied Manila. General Masaharu Homma, commander of the Japanese 14th Army, had been given 50 days to conquer the Philippines. But Homma knew that as long as the Yusofe forces continued to hold Bataan and Corregidor, he could not accomplish his mission. To buy time for an active defense on Bataan, the Yusofe forces set up delaying lines on the main road leading to the peninsula. The units manning these lines were tasked to stall the Japanese advance, and they did, in heroic fashion.
We had a Major Donovan, and he found a way to get rid of them. He circled the sugarcane field and set it on fire, and the Japanese came out of there in a hurry. And it was a sort of a duck shoot at that point in time.
Despite being tired from combat and a long withdrawal, the 21st Division in Pora and the 71st Division in Layak, supported by Philippine Scout artillery batteries, slowed down the enemy war machine. Ah! At Layak Junction, Jose Calugas, a mess sergeant of the Philippine Scouts, sprang into action after one of his unit's guns got hit by advancing Japanese tanks. He ran forward under enemy fire and mobilized 2 days Philippine Army lieutenants. Manning their 75mm cannon, they continuously fired at the enemy. For this exceptional act of heroism, Sergeant Calugas was awarded the U.S. Congressional Medal of Honor, the only Filipino to win this award in World War II. After the long withdrawal to Bataan, the defenders now felt it was time to stand fast and face the enemy squarely. The first main line of defense in Bataan stretched from Mauban in the west to Abucay in the east. The western section was defended by the 1st Corps, while the eastern section was guarded by the 2nd Corps. Arrayed against the 80,000-strong Filipino-American forces were some 60,000 battle-hardened Japanese troops. Although outnumbered, the Japanese held the upper hand because of superior arms and logistics and control over air and sea. The Japanese launched their main attack on the east side of the Abucay Line. But despite repeated attempts, they failed to break the 41st Division, commanded by General Vicente Lim, the first Filipino graduate of West Point. Meanwhile, inside Manila Bay, Q-boats of the Philippine Offshore Patrol also distinguished themselves in action.
Half an hour. Air-sea battle between 9 planes and 2 Q-boats. And we hit 3 of them. We shot down 3.
However, the gallant stand of the 41st Division and the other Yusofe units could not stave off a Japanese breakthrough on the western side of the Abucay Line. Faced with a roadblock which threatened to cut off the Yusofe front lines, the Bataan defenders were forced to move back. Outflanked as well on the eastern side, the defenders withdrew southward to their second and final defense position. This was the Bataan defenders' moment of truth. They had to hold the Orion-Bagac line at all costs. If this line were to be broken, the defense of Bataan would collapse. The Japanese launched attack after attack on the Orion-Bagac line. Again and again, they suffered heavy losses. In a bid to outflank the Filipino-American forces, General Homma sent a battalion by boat to land behind the line.
And they were already in the streets, you know, in the road. And the Air Force and the PC and what
have you, you know. They fought back.
The Japanese were spotted as they emerged on separate points of shoreline. The ragtag USAFAR units defending their rear positions ferociously. The Japanese attackers were annihilated. At the height of the action, Jose Tando, a Philippine constabulary captain, rose to the occasion. Tando's heroics helped win what came to be known as the Battle of the Points. While the second line was still being formed, Japanese infiltrators managed to break through. Cut off from their units on the other side of the line, the Japanese troops consolidated and became a threat to the Bataan defenders.
It was a jungle warfare where you can hear the sound of the Japanese rifle, but you could not see where they come from.
American tanks were deployed to crush the enemy inside USAFAR lines. But the dense jungle made it virtually impossible to pinpoint the Japanese positions. Igoro troops from the 11th Division came to the rescue.
Filipino soldiers, or whoever they were, would jump on top of the tanks to try to lead the tank to where the Japanese were.
A lot of Japanese got killed in that action. Not only in the pocket that was wiped out, but even those that attacked the front lines. They were doing bonsai attack there in the front lines, trying to penetrate our line, but they were not able to come through.
Coordinated action gradually wiped out the infiltrating Japanese units in what became known as the Battle of the Pockets.
With the Phil American victories in the Battle of the Points and the Battle of the Pockets, General Homma realized his worst nightmare. It was already mid-February in 1942, and the determined Bataan defenders were still holding their ground. Japanese troops had suffered grievously. 2,275 men killed in action, and 4,049 wounded.
By contrast, elsewhere in Asia and the Pacific, the Japanese war machine was moving swiftly forward, conquering Guam, Hong Kong, Wake Island, Malaya, and Singapore. Faced with a high casualty rate and the inability to break the USAFAR defense in Bataan, General Homma decided to pull back and await reinforcements. There now ensued a lull in the fighting that would last 45 days. Unable to win with their guns, the Japanese resorted to propaganda to break the spirit of the Filipinos and turn them against the Americans.
They dropped leaflets about women, so forth, making us think of our families. They thought of this as entertainment.
But the morale of the Bataan defenders remained high. The defenders were motivated to fight harder when they learned the story of Erlinda, a young Filipina who had been raped and killed by the Japanese. "Remember Erlinda," became the cry of defiance.
USAFER headquarters tried to boost morale further through stirring broadcasts from the Voice of Freedom in Corregidor.
Lieutenant Norman Reyes, sa English portion, Tagalog portion naman, si then Lieutenant Francisco Isidoro. Talagang mataas ang moral namin. Lalo nung marinig namin na a mile-long convoy is on the way.
The propaganda then was that President Roosevelt is sending a long convoy of reinforcements. So just keep on holding, Bataan. Keep on holding.
But there was no convoy coming. Little did the Filipino-American soldiers know that the United States government had reached a decision that virtually made them sacrificial pawns. After Pearl Harbor, the U.S. would pour its remaining resources to helping the Allies win the war in Europe first, before making its move in the Pacific. To make matters worse, food and medicine were in short supply.
We were eating iguana, we were eating snakes, and I must tell you that once we got back into Bataan, the Philippine scouts did not need their horses anymore, and we started to eat horses.
Lugaw. And then later on, salm kamote with lugaw. And then later on, kangkong with lugaw.
50% casualties, and the Philippine Army was just sitting in their foxhole with malaria.
We had to put up a cemetery nearby. We buried them ourselves.
President Quezon, growing frustrated over American inaction, proposed that the Philippines be immediately declared independent and neutral. Then he would order the American and Japanese armed forces out of the country. When U.S. President Roosevelt disapproved, Quezon sarcastically remarked, "How typically American to anguish over the fate of a distant cousin while a daughter is being raped in the back room." But with the Philippines isolated, it was no longer safe to keep President Quezon and General MacArthur in the country. Quezon was evacuated by submarine, while MacArthur left Corregidor by PT boat en route to Australia. Just before leaving, MacArthur promised to return.
Tonight, I repeat those words. Yeah. I shall return.
In the meantime, he called on General Jonathan Wainwright to take over the command. Major General Edward King was named commander of the Bataan forces. The Filipino and American forces were nearing the breaking point. But the stubborn defense of Bataan and Corregidor had put the Philippines on the world map and gained recognition for the Filipino soldier. British Prime Minister Winston Churchill praised the Filipino soldier as the best warrior in the world. And U.S. President Roosevelt saluted the Filipinos for upholding the most magnificent traditions of free democracy.
I say that again and again.
At this point, however, the troops needed more than a morale boost. They needed food, ammunition, and air support. This never came. By contrast, the Japanese had reinforcements on the way and were determined to crush the defenders of Bataan. As April 1942 began, the USAFET troops, weakened by hunger and disease, were still holding on.
People could still laugh and joke. It seemed that mostly people were accepted their fate.
With fresh troops, the Japanese launched their final offensive on April 3, Good Friday. Their Their first goal was to capture Mount Samat. From this central high ground, the Japanese could see and split the USAFE lines, making isolated Phil American forces easy prey.
They kept on bombing. We thought that we will die.
The defenders were physically weak and weary, but they put up a fierce fight against the revitalized enemy.
That even if they were in the foxholes, they were firing their arms just to show that they wanted to fight, but...
The Japanese opened with a fierce artillery barrage on both the front lines and the rear positions. Bombers attack anything that moved, burning forest cover in the dry summer heat.
So we never thought that we could ever get out of that place anymore.
With Mount Samat in their hands, the Japanese pressed on, giving their adversary no chance to regroup. Filipino and American forces planned temporary defense lines but were pushed back. The U.S. 31st Infantry Regiment and units of the Philippine Scouts tried to mount a counterattack but were repulsed. Eventually, the front lines collapsed in the face of the relentless assault.
Yung malalaking bato doon sa babaw namang Mount Samat, inuukay namin sa lalim na yung ganun para ikuha namin sa mga punagay. Wala na kami mga balay.
With no further organized resistance possible and assured that the prisoners would be treated humanely, General King decided to surrender the entire Bataan force to the Japanese.
Bataan has fallen.
On Corregidor, the voice of freedom broadcast the fall of Bataan.
Blood-stained peninsula have laid down their arms.
Marami sa amin ang naluha. Noong marinig namin yung broadcast na yan. Ano magagawa namin? Parang ganyan.
It was only after the fighting stopped that the Japanese realized that they had more than 66,000 Filipino soldiers and over 10,000 American troops as prisoners of war. The Japanese now found themselves facing an overwhelming logistical challenge for which they were unprepared. They devised a plan that called for gathering the POWs in the towns of Mariveles and Balanga and marching them to San Fernando, Pampanga. From there, the prisoners would board cargo trains to Capas, Tarlac for a final walk to the O'Donnell prison camp. This 100-kilometer ordeal came to be known as the Death March.
It was early, you know. It was summer, April, ang init.
They took my watch, they took a ring, they took my wallet, they took everything I had.
Some prisoners never even made it to the death march. But their fate was no less tragic. Most notable among these were over 400 officers and men from various USAFE units who were forcibly assembled by the Japanese near the Pantingan River.
Hands were now tied, connected to each other by these telephone wires.
Umaira wa nanni mo shinakutei! Jitto shiteru dake da!
The Japanese commander gave an order, they all fixed bayonet.
Susume!
The death march took its toll on the rest of the POWs. Given meager rations and deprived of water, many died by the roadside.
becomes a question of time before you just want water so bad you'll do anything to get it.
Some who fell out of line or delayed the march were simply bayoneted by their Japanese captors.
We decided that when somebody was already sick and could not walk, we had two of us among those who were healthy had to carry him so that he will not impede the march.
In a show of solidarity, townspeople along the route pitch in their support, tossing food and water to the prisoners and helping some escape.
I don't remember who they were, but I remember a Filipino girl that used to give me a babinka.
At the San Fernando rail station, those prisoners who had survived the march found out that their ordeal was far from over.
And they packed us into these cars, 100 or better to a car. And they were little cars to begin with, no air. In that car alone, where I was at, men died standing up and had no room to fall down.
In sum, more than 15,000 Filipinos and Americans are estimated to have died or escaped during the death march. The fall of Bataan now left Corregidor isolated. Yet to the surprise of the Japanese, the valiant defenders of the rock continued to hold out.
The common feeling of all the people that I was with that we were going to fight to the end, like the Alamo, you know. We would fight until we were all gone.
Elsewhere in the archipelago, other Filipinos continued to defy the Japanese as well. Among these courageous patriots was Supreme Court Chief Justice Jose Abad Santos, who refused to collaborate with the enemy.
He cautioned me, he said, "Do not cry, Pepito. Show these people that you're brave, that everybody is given the opportunity to die for one country." He marched proudly with his shirt flapping. And then after that, I went up to the house and I took my prayer book and read the prayer for the dead. And after a few minutes, I heard a volley of shots and I knew that my father was gone.
After a month of daily heavy bombardment, the Japanese finally launched their invasion of Corregidor on the night of May 5, 1942.
Amidst shelling and firing, protektado sila. Kanilang itaas, kanilang dagat. Kaya walang nagawa. Pero ang Corregidor fired all the guns they had.
Despite the odds, the Corregidor defenders inflicted heavy losses on the invaders. But with air and artillery supremacy, the Japanese were able to establish a beachhead. With enemy tanks on the island and the hospital in Malinta Tunnel at risk, General Wainwright was forced to surrender. It was May 6, 1942, 27 days after Bataan had fallen. The Corregidor POWs were marched through the streets of Manila on the way to Bilibid Prison where they were initially confined. Eventually, the defenders of Corregidor were taken to Camp O'Donnell to join their comrades from Bataan.
Ang buhay pala doon. Anak na. Hopeless.
Because in our barracks where we were assigned, we were about 200. In a barracks that can accommodate only about 100. Just a minute.
Ako mapit sa akin sakit, malaria at beriberi. Yan. At nagkaroon pa ng yung mga kuto ng manok sa katawan namin.
Pag gising mo sa umaga, madilim pa, nababanaagan mo yung napakahabang konvoy. Pasan-pasan yung mga patay. Pag madilim na lumulubog ng araw, mahaba pa rin. Tantsahin nyo.
The rate would be as high as 500 deaths a day. So obviously there were a lot of people that weren't even discovered to be dead. They'd be under the barracks or whatnot for quite some time.
The fall of Bataan and Corregidor marked the end of organized resistance against the Japanese. But the guerrilla movement would continue the fight across the country, keeping the flame of patriotism alive. These guerrillas, many of them veterans of Bataan and Corregidor, would continually harass the occupation forces. In no small measure, they paved the way for the triumphant return of General Douglas MacArthur and the Allied forces in 1944. Bataan and Corregidor are surrounded by historical myth. For too long, so many have tainted these bastions of freedom with notions of defeat. Others insist that those battles were all part of a war we shouldn't have fought. But the fact is that thousands of Filipinos, rich and poor, fought side by side against incredible odds in defense of our country.
Our country was invaded by Japan. Whether it was invaded because of America or not, it seems to me that it should not matter. It is our country and it's our duty to defend it.
The significance of Bataan is it demonstrated the spirit of the Filipino as a soldier, as a fighting man.
1941 was a call for preparedness, you see. It's a lesson that we cannot afford to miss again.
When I wear my Corregidor hat, survivor, I'm often asked when I go through grocery lines and places like that, what's that? Nobody knows, you know, really. It's to me, the Koreans call theirs the Forgotten War, but I think Corregidor Bataan is a forgotten war.
Kung ikaw ay tapat sa bayan, maalala mong pareho.
This is a legacy that must not be forgotten. By their unity, courage, and sacrifice, the heroes of Bataan and Corregidor passed the torch of freedom and nationhood to you and me. By their example, they have shown that no force is strong enough to extinguish that flame. Faced with any challenge, we Filipinos have the capacity to prevail. I'm Joel Torre. Thank you for watching.
I hope you enjoyed watching Legacy of Heroes. It is more than just a historical video documentary. The story of the defenders of Bataan and Corregidor reminds us of the price of the freedom that we take for granted today. It also prods us to remember what a united, gallant, and patriotic people can achieve. Let us march forward in the footsteps of our heroes to create the strong republic we have longed for all these years.